Where's Misha? Nashville. It gives me a dime. Where's Misha? Honestly, I don't give a crap. But where's Misha? I've had it up from here. No, but seriously, where's Misha? Oh, my honest answer? Yeah. Oh, no! Oh, Jesus. Where's Misha? I don't know. Oh, thanks. Many bunch of Republican Southerners found Misha Cobbs and received this crap online about politics and grabbed him, shoved him up a flagpole, and now they're flying him high and saluting him while they're saying, take that, Collins. There's your politics and time for crap. All I want to hear you do is be an angel, be funny, be all fun and done and crap. Don't be political. Don't do that.
But where's Misha?
Honestly, I don't know.
But where's Misha?
But seriously, dude, where's Misha? No, no bullshit. I don't know. The theory that came out in the song was that you'd be kidnapped by Southern Republicans who had strung you up a flagpole. I don't like it either, but we had to think of worst case scenarios because Misha's never late.
And likely scenarios.
He's never late except for every city we visit.
I feel like I am actually just set up for failure, by the way. Like, I went directly to my meet and greet, and then
which was on a boat. Yeah, sure, maybe we didn't have to go on a boat, but we did. And then we went directly from there to a very brief bathroom break to,
God damn it, I'm late again.
Yeah. When you walk, when you round the corner,
I
say, can't count on him. No, you can't. I know, but you know what? It's good.
No, traditionally, I think the idea is that you get up and like you introduce someone, you're like, oh, you're gonna love this person, so exciting.
Right.
Like, so sorry, he's disappointed you again.
Getting into your quality time. Yeah, fewer questions.
That's the theme of the song.
The great thing is you have two theme songs. Like, you're the only guy. We have on time, Misha. But play them on time, Misha, just so the good people in Nashville can hear the on. Go out of here, we'll do the intro.
This, by the way, is a song I've never heard before.
Okay, here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, a guy that you just saw seconds ago, we're going to see him again. Put your hands together for all of Watch's face, Misha Collins. Imagine a world where that was your intro. Watch, we'll walk me through this. So you arrive on site, on time.
And I knew there was a
catch. You're backstage, and suddenly the band plays that. You come out to a cacophony of roars and screams of delight.
That would be amazing. I feel so good about myself.
Give you a round. I mean, and that's a doable.
I actually can't imagine.
That's an achievable goal.
I love that you being on time and on site.
On time. It is doable. I think we need to encourage him. We can make this happen.
Yeah, he can do it. And yet at the same time, it's Misha.
I don't know.
If it's Misha.
Yes, it is. At this point, I'm not sure. Ladies and gentlemen.
That's Misha.
That's Misha Collins.
So speaking of being on time, last night we wrapped late. Around 1, and then went to catch the last flight. I got in my seat and I took a sleep. Pretty, that's it. And then about 45 minutes later, the pilot was like, "Well, I'm in trouble. Everybody's gonna have to get off the plane." And I was like, "No, no,
no! Don't do this to me. I can't even feel my hands." And now I have to figure out how to get to Nashville at 2 o'clock in the morning.
So needless to say, I was in a very, very, very cozy middle seat on a connecting flight that left at 6 a.m. and I am feeling fresh and rested. How would everyone feel about me just napping up here?
Can we film it?
It would be a memorable panel. People would be able to say, I remember when I was actually at the last creation convention ever. I remember the moment when they canceled their entire future calendar. So lovely to be here. What?
We love you.
Whoa. Well, this is helping me work through the sort of guilt and pain of being tardy today, so thank you for the affirmations. Nashville's always a city that we just look forward to. It's exciting to come to Nashville. You guys know that about yourselves? Yeah, all right, well, that's all I can say on that topic. Does anyone have any questions they want to ask me, or topics they want to discuss? Anything at all?
Okay.
I can tell you that we are just a few days away from the very end of season 13.
Yes.
Last night was Friday the 13th. Woo! In the last episode of the 13th season of Supernatural. I have to admit, I was kind of wondering whether I was going to survive. It just felt like a lot of 13s all in one place. But yeah, we're almost done. We have four more days of shooting, and then that's it. I know, it's exciting. And sleep. All right, what's your question?
Okay, my question is that last year during GypCon, you guys, during your panel with Jensen, there was a time where you were trying to explain that your kids like to sing in the car.
Yes.
And he wouldn't allow you to actually finish your story.
You know what? If I could remember this event, I would be curious. I often have that problem where I am telling a witty, insightful, maybe meaningful, moving story, and Jensen won't let me get it out because he's jealous. But he doesn't have any stories like that. So what were we talking about?
So you guys were just discussing about the kids singing in the car, and then Jensen said, well, that was a natural segue into something else, and that there was something that you had just told him about, and he was wondering if you had announced it to the world, and he whispered it to you, and you pretty much was going, oh my God, don't say that. I was just wondering if we
should
were
we pull the video?
To know what that was.
Oh, so you don't want to hear the story about my kid? You're a Jensen mole. I have no idea what that could have been. I have no secrets. That's not true.
It's many secrets.
But I will happily finish the story about my kids. My kids have a really interesting relationship with music for some reason. When Wes was young, when he was like two, he hated the car. Like the minute you put him in the car, he started screaming his head off. Unless you played Peaches really, really loud. And Peaches, there's no young children in the audience, are there? Okay, just cover their ears for a sec. So Peaches, for instance, has a song that goes, fuck the pain away, fuck the pain away. Like over and over again. And Wes would be, all of a sudden, he'd be like, ah! And then, it was this amazing musical elixir that fixed everything for him. So that's interesting. West has a playlist. He's always like, put that on my playlist when he hears a song that he loves. And you listen to the playlist, and you're like, wow, this is a very eclectic and excellent selection of music. More sophisticated taste by far than mine. And then Mason, I made a little video of Mason. Here's the other problem with kids. So if they hear a song once, they know the lyrics. And they never forget them. And so Mason was probably just about three. And I made the mistake of just randomly playing music on my iPhone in the minivan, and the song came on, and I was like, oh, before, you know, I wasn't paying attention, and then I was like, oh, no, and I stopped it, but I stopped it too late. And then for about 4 or 5 months after that, Mason would always just sing that song. And I made this little video of her. Yeah, you know what I mean. Video of her sitting in her car seat in the minivan singing, "The naked Dutch painter in the kitchen does not want to fuck you."
So beautiful. So sweet, so cute.
Do you have any idea what Jensen was talking about?
No.
You're gonna have to ask him, but I don't remember.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi. So my name is Tatum.
Hi.
I was just wondering, when you got to play Lucifer and you had to kind of channel him, like, how much fun did you have with that? And like, how difficult was it for you to kind of channel something so different than Cass?
I had a lot of fun with it, and it was quite difficult. Mark Pellegrino is an excellent actor, and he had sort of established that character with a lot of detail and nuance. And so, I thought I'll try to encapsulate as much of what he did as possible, so it actually looks like a consistent character. Problem with that for somebody like me is that, as I mentioned, Mark Pellegrino is an actual actor. So, in order to mimic that, you have to really pretend to be an actor yourself. That's quite challenging. I went over to his apartment in Vancouver the morning before starting to shoot that, and he was very gracious about it, and actually helped me cheat. So I said, what would you do in this scene if you were playing Lucifer? And then I watched him, and I then tried to do the same thing. So it was helpful. And he told me, couple of pointers about his internal monologue for Lucifer. He said, in every scene with every scene partner, he's thinking, either I want to kill you, or I want to have sex with you. Those are the two things that he's thinking about. So now, subsequently, I've been in scenes with Mark when he's playing Lucifer. And his gaze feels like a bit of a violation. You know, because I know what's going on in his head. Thanks for asking. Yeah. Hi.
Hello. I would like to know your opinion on a very serious matter.
Yes.
Out of Sam, Dean, and Castiel, who is the space cowboy, who is the gangster of love, and who is Maurice?
That's tough. I think it's pretty clear that Cass is Maurice, but then the question is the gangster of love and the space cowboy. In a weird way, I think Dean is both of those. But that sort of leaves Sam hanging out to dry. Could he be Maurice's assistant? Did that fill it out okay? Does that work?
I think that will suffice, yes.
Okay, all right. That reminds me of a fantastic thing that happened yesterday. So we're on set, and Alexander has a line, And the line, I hope isn't.
Go ahead!
It is a bit of a spoiler. Hold on. Let me see if I can phrase this the right way. Okay, so there's a bit of dialogue that is, kill Maggie. And that he has to say. He has to say, kill Maggie. And then there's other words on either end of that, but I can remove that, take it out of context so it doesn't ruin the show for people. So he gets to say, Maggie. Kill Maggie. So we're rolling. He says, kill Mary. Fuck! So he literally said those three words because he accidentally said Mary instead of Maggie, and then he's like... And the entire crew started laughing hilariously, and then Rankin won. You know the game I'm talking about. The
film. I don't know if I just know that game.
Probably somebody in the audience doesn't know it. But we're not going to explain it. You can ask your neighbors. Hi.
Hi, my name's Tyler, and if you could bring anybody back to life, because there is a coming of war, would you bring back JD in?
Because there's a coming war, is that what you said?
There is a coming war, and you do need help.
Well, if I say no, and JDM watches this, I'm in deep shit, so... Absolutely, I'd bring back JD. Yes. I like that line of thinking. You basically gave me no options. I like that kind of question because it sort of simplifies things for me. I don't have to think. I just say yes, and then I'm in your good graces. Right? Yeah. All right. Well played. Hi.
My question is: do you have a favorite scene that you've done with Jared and Jensen?
There's so many.
I have scenes that stand out the most for me. I mean, what do you mean by favorite?
I don't know.
Like least awful? There was a period of time when I would look at the call sheet. I would look at the scenes, and if it was like 1, 2, 3, which is our character numbers. Jared's 1, Jensen's 2, and 3. I would be like, oh, this is gonna be hell. Because they would just mess with me. And I actually think at a certain point the writers might have decided to stop doing that so much and like separate us off because we wasted so much time laughing. I don't know, there's a scene from an episode called My Bloody Valentine. And it always just stands out to me because I think it encapsulated the dynamic that we had as performers on set really nicely. It's a scene in a morgue, and Jared and Jensen are standing on one side of this stainless steel table, and I approach from across the room. And I walk up to the table, and I, as I'm walking, I say my line. I don't remember what it was, but it was something like. And I get up to the table, and Jared immediately starts fondling my balls with a broom handle under the table. And from the other room where the directors are watching on a monitor, all they see is me laughing and nobody else doing anything wrong. So Misha pull it together. You know, Misha, what's wrong? And I'm like, but this is so hard, and not in that way. And so eventually the first AD takes the broom away from Jared. Jared, unfortunately, is quite limber and long-legged. And so he would do this on the table. And then eventually they figured out a way to restrain his legs. And then we do another take, and then I come up and I... And Jared is like making some ridiculous face. And then Jensen says, hey, Misha, just don't say the line name at all. Just say it to me. I was like, thank God. There's one professional. And so I did it one more time. I came up and I went, came up to the table, but I said my line to Jensen instead of Jared. And Jensen goes, that's basically the environment that I go to work to. And it fills me with dread. The camera dolly. This is another, I haven't mentioned this yet, but this was only a few weeks ago. Camera dolly came up to me and said, hey, Misha, thank you. There's a technique that you might want to try. When someone's trying to make you laugh, just in your head, imagine that you hate them and you want to kill them. So now you know, and this is a little inside secret, now you know that like starting maybe 5 or 6 episodes ago, from about then on, Castiel's subtext is, I hate you. I'm just trying not to laugh. But it's very effective, so you can use that too. Right. Thank you. Thank you. Hi.
Hi. The kid with JDM and no choice, that was my kid.
Oh my goodness.
So he signed his
He's all grown up.
Question.
Oh, okay. Wow.
So now I have nothing really to ask him, so sorry.
Oh, he stole your question.
So he kind of did, but in his honor, no, he didn't steal my question. I didn't have one. But in his, just thinking of him, what were you through your mind whenever you were told that you guys were going to do a Scooby-Doo episode?
Oh. I have no idea what that has to do with your son.
Well, because Scooby-Doo's his favorite. I'm sorry.
Oh, okay, all right. Thanks for filling that in. I was thrilled. I love this show the most when it takes the most absurd risks and does the most unexpected things. So, Scooby-Doo episode, The French Mistake, Baby. There's a few episodes that just thought so far outside the box and dared to do something completely new that I just love. To me, that feels like you're on the vanguard of something. You're inventing something. And as somebody who, you know, grew up with Scooby-Doo as like ambient background, whenever you went over to somebody's house, Scooby-Doo was on. It was just a big part of my early childhood. And these like incredibly familiar characters, and then to actually be animated in with them is so surreal. There have been a handful of moments in my career when I have just felt these sort of pinch-me moments, like, I can't believe this is happening. This is so cool. That was one of them. One of them was somebody asked at a panel toward the end of last year. Somebody asked me if you could have coffee with anyone living or dead. Who would it be? And I said, well, you know, I've always loved this radio personality, Bob Garfield. He's just like he's really amazing, really smart, and really works outside of normal parameters. 2 days later, I get a call from him. And I was like, this is actually the coolest thing ever! So there are these little touchstone moments that I've had in the last few years where I just felt like, oh my god, this is the coolest thing. Another one was when I... Gishwiz. Gishwiz is the scavenger hunt that I have been running for some time. And one year, I wrote an item that was get an astronaut on the space station, currently on the space station, to hold up a sign with your team's name on it and take a picture. And NASA posted on their official Twitter feed, "We are astronauts alone. They have real science to do." But I was like, but we got recognized by NASA's official Twitter feed. That's pretty good. And so then the next year, we did the scavenger hunt again, and I wrote another item for NASA. And it started with, last year NASA told us to leave their astronauts alone. I'm sure they've been kicking themselves all year for that rash decision. Here's another chance. And then, again, it was written in space. Long story short, NASA ends up officially naming a mountain on Mars Gishwiz and posting Mount Gishwiz with a picture of it on their official Twitter feed. Honestly, when that happened, that was another moment in the world. I just named a mountain on Mars. Some gibberish word. It's probably not going to get any better than that. But anyway, that's a long-winded way of saying that I feel like the Scooby Doo episode was one of those rare moments when you're just so elated that it feels like you could die happy. Yeah. And then, by the way, it was also really cool that we had the premiere screening of the Scooby episode before it aired on TV. It was screened in the Kodak Theater in Hollywood, which is where the Oscars happen. So we're in like the Oscars auditorium, with, you know, people packed in the balcony, all there to watch an episode of a TV show on the CW that's been around for 13 years. And that was also so awesome, to sit in the audience and watch that, and then to get up on the Oscars stage and talk about this weird crossover animated episode, you know, was pretty gratifying. Because, you know, as you know, Supernatural has been repeatedly snubbed by the Oscars, so. We got our come up instead.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is my daughter Beatrice.
Hi.
Meeting and seeing you is her 13th birthday present.
Why are you embarrassing her?
I know, it's great.
wait, it's the other way around. You're here for her?
No, we embarrass each other.
Oh, you do embarrass each other? Well, it's nice to have that. Back and forth, the two-way street dynamic in any relationship.
Okay, so my question is...
Oh, is she embarrassing? Yeah, how's it feel now?
My question is, I'm a genealogist. It did not take me long to get a hold of your family tree.
Okay. Do I have anything to worry about?
No, because all I wanted to know, being very involved in my own family history, is... why Bertha Collins, and why the Collins name? What was that relation to you that you chose that name out of the many names that you had to choose from?
Why do I go by the last name of Collins, is what you're asking?
Professionally, yes.
Are you a professional genealogist or an amateur genealogist?
I've been doing it for about 30 years, so okay. I'm gonna go with professional. I've done it for clients, yes.
Okay, people hire you to stalk their families.
Yes. And I enjoy it.
So long story short, when I first started acting, I would go into auditions and people would think that I was gonna have a Russian accent. And that was at a time when there was like a lot of Russian gangsters in, you know, various different TV shows and stuff. So it was like, interesting. You got rid of your accent or whatever. And I thought, you know what? First of all, Dmitry Krushnik is really hard to pronounce. Second of all, Misha is what I've always gone by. I've been called Misha since I was a little kid. So professionally being called Misha felt better to me. I didn't want people calling me Dmitry because the only people that call me that is the IRS. So then I just started sort of playing around with different ideas of other possible last names. And I just recently found like a list of the names that I could have, like me and Vicky were kicking around different ideas for fake last names, which is a weird project. And Collins was my mother's 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 maiden name. I think I may have gotten that right. I know that at one point I got that wrong on stage, and people online were like, he's so stupid, he doesn't even know his own name. What if you have a real fucking genealogist? That was probably you. Yes, here's my card. So it's my grandmother who lives in Baltimore, her mother's maiden name. And so it felt like I wasn't 100% prostituting myself by changing my name, because it felt like there was a family connection. And it meant a great deal to my grandmother. She really loves the fact that I took that as my stage name. So there's the brief history of my thinking.
Well, I love that too.
And now it's funny because I have been called Misha Collins by everybody for so long now that Dmitri Crush feels like a weird alien Russian gangster that I don't really know. And Vicky will often refer to herself as Vicky Collins. And our kids have the legal last name of Collins. So when we travel together as a group, and it's Dmitri Krushnik and Vicky Mantok and two Collins kids, it's clear to everyone that we're kidnapping them. Thank you.
First, I was just going to say, I've loved your character since you came on season 4. You're my favorite. Whenever you left the show temporarily, I was so sad. You're my favorite.
Thank you. We should probably get it recorded in the same
way. Anyway, my question is, because of that, at the time when you started being Castiel, the only what I know of what Eric Kripke based Castiel off of John Constantine, and from what when I was at that time, I think Keanu Reeves was the only person who did an adaptation of John Constantine. So I was curious to know what you did to prepare for Castiel. Did you take nods from Keanu, or was it John Constantine in general? What did you do to prepare to be Castiel? Or did you say, hey, go into a deep voice, hey, that's Castiel?
More the latter. I like the idea of like having taken my acting inspiration from Keanu Reeves.
He's not John Williams, by the way.
Yeah. There was a. I'm not going to talk about Keanu Reeves. Okay. So, in the script, it described, in the first script that Castiel showed up, it described the character wearing a trench coat, a suit, a rumpled suit, and a tie. And then it said, a la Constantine. So, the Constantine reference in the script was really about the look of Castiel and not a description of the character. So, I just looked at like a comic book picture of Constantine, and I was like, okay, that's the look. But I didn't go to Constantine or Keanu Reeves for inspiration on the performance.
That's okay. You're great.
I do. No. Thanks for trying to throw me a lifeline. So the character came to me as an audition. Originally, I didn't get the whole script, and the audition was for a demon on Supernatural. And I didn't, and I went in and I prepared the character as a demon, or what I thought a demon would do, which was quite sinister. And then I did it once through. Eric Kripke, the creator, was in the audition, and he said, okay, that was good, but we didn't want this to get out there, so we didn't put it out when we sent the sides out to agents, but this character is actually an angel, not a demon. Can you do it again as an angel? And I'm like, I don't know what a demon does in the first place. I don't know what an angel does. And so it was kind of this weird Hail Mary moment where I just was like, okay, and I did it different. I did have one thing at that point, which was in the script, it said that in the sides that we had, which is like the portion of the script that they give you, it said that Castiel was trying to communicate with Dean when he was not in his human vessel. He was trying to communicate with Dean, and his angel voice was like blowing out windows and exploding televisions and stuff. That happened in Lazarus Rising, the first episode that I was in. And so I thought, all right, Castiel should have this like deep, like resonant, powerful voice, and not my normal sort of squeaky voice. And so I did that, for the voice. And then, I did a little bit more work, sort of developing the character. And I, in order to, do that deep voice, I sort of just like had to sort of scrape my voice, like as if with cheese grater, like just like really rough on the voice. But I was like, oh, whatever, it's just a couple episodes.
So
10 years later. At one point I went to the doctors, because I was like, I just have like a chronic sore throat, I don't know what it is. And the doctor figured out it was a casting voice. So I should be getting some sort of worker's comp.
Hey, how are you?
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, thank you.
So I was going to ask, if you could be any creature besides an angel, what would you be?
Mm.
Not an earthworm. I mean, it's been quite in the supernatural universe. I'm assuming. I'm gonna take the question to that. It's been kind of great playing the character that I play on the show because I got to do so many different things. I got to be human. I got to be crazy. That's not really a thing, but it's an iteration. I got to be Lucifer, which was amazing, and be God, which felt right. So, I mean, I think that the only way to really trade up, I got to be the keeper of the empty. I got to be the Leviathan. Did I get to be in games? Probably not. An action figure? I got to be an action figure. Jimmy Nomad, yes. So I think God, though, is sort of the apex. It's pretty good. It's a pretty good gig if you can get it. So that, I would take that.
Thanks.
Although I have to say, of all the characters, playing Lucifer for me was the most fun.
You did awesome. I really loved Lucifer.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes?
Hi, so is there anything that you would like about your character to be changed in season 14?
Well, it would be so cool, wouldn't it, if in season 14, Cass came back being like, hey guys, how's it going? Cass has he has a little backpack that he carries around, and a little tube that comes out of a compressed helium canister. No, I just feel more like me when I talk like this. It would be a great thing to weave into the story, if for nothing else, for my vocal cords. And I know I would love to see the writers have to justify that for an entire season. Like, there we go, Isaac sucking on that hose again? Shame on you for taking it there. Yes, what's your question? Hi.
My name is Mary, and my question is about Thursday's episode. It's about seeing that Gabriel kill evil Colonel Sanders.
You're at a con.
And if you think he's really gone, or if he's gonna be back, like if it was that easy to kill him.
Well, okay, so I'm sort of painted into a bit of a corner here because I know the answer to the question. What do you want me to do?
Tell us!
Tell you? I could save everybody a whole lot of trouble and a whole lot of wasted television watching if I just tell you how the season ends right now, if you want that.
Yes!
Would that be helpful?
Yes!
There are a few people with like their heads down and their fingers in their ears because they really don't trust me. I'm not going to tell you because I get tired. Yeah, I mean, look, Gabe's back in town, and he's powerful, and he's an archangel, and like, don't mess with archangels is a very important lesson. I mean, I think that Supernatural is filled with a lot of little pieces of moral advice or guideposts, and I think that one of them very much is, and that you can, I think, apply in everyday life. And one of those is, don't mess with archangels. Because they'll kill you with ease.
Thank you.
That was really unsatisfying. That's okay. That usually never happens. Hi.
Hi. I was wondering, do you have a favorite type of acting to do? Do you enjoy like action, comedy, drama? Do you have a preference?
My favorite scenes to do are ones that don't have Jared Jensen in them. I actually don't have a good answer for that. I like doing either really, really good, believable drama that feels like I get sucked into it and I lose myself. And I like doing comedy because it can be just so much fun. Action on camera is, I don't love. Because it's often very, very technical.
and it's all fake. We're not, I learned this the hard way, but we're not actually allowed to punch each other. And so it's kind of a weird choreography, and we also, almost always in a fight scene, we break it up into little pieces, so you don't play out the whole scene typically in one continuous flow. You do, you know, a handful of hits, and then you redo those handful of hits again, and you change the camera angle, and you do it again. And you just get very sort of mechanical and technical, so that's not, it's not my favorite.
Hi. What was your proudest moment in your acting career?
Scooby-Doo.
No.
I don't know. It's a great question. Have I told you guys I must have my Anakin Skywalker story? I'm not hearing a lot of yeses, so
I've heard it.
This was a pretty proud moment for me. I was a finalist for the role of young Anakin Skywalker, and my agent got a call and said, "I want you to come up to Skywalker Ranch, meet with George Lucas. It's down to you and four other guys." And I was like, "Why?" This was so amazing, and they said, "But one thing, you cannot tell anybody why you're going up there." Even the driver that's picking you up from an SMO airport can't know why you're going to Skywalker Ranch. You have to tell them that you're going there to do a looping session. And that it has nothing to do with Star Wars. And if you tell anyone, you won't get the job. In fact, the kid that was cast as the young, like, five-year-old Anakin Skywalker, he told somebody, so we recast him, and the guy that's in the movie wasn't our first choice. So don't tell anybody. And I was like, got it, I won't tell anybody. I'm not talking to anybody about this. I didn't tell my friends, I didn't tell anyone. And went up there, I got to the Skywalker Ranch a little early, and so I just walked around the property and in the woods, and I remember I was like in the woods, and then I came up to this huge field, and there were all these llamas like on the hilltop, silhouetted, and I was just like, this is so awesome. I'm on Skywalker Ranch, and there's these wild beasts. And I felt so alive, and I went in and I met with George Lucas one-on-one, and he let me play with Luke Skywalker's real lightsaber from the original Star Wars, and it was just like the most thrilling moment of my life. And then I left, and I had a little time before catching my flight, and it's about an hour and 20 minutes back into San Francisco from the Skywalker Ranch, but I went into the city, was killing some time, and I was on Haight Street, and I walked into a pizza place, and I got a pizza by the slice, and I had, on the drive down, I was like, I just want to call my best friend and just tell him. And then I was like, no, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to tell anybody. I'm not going to tell anybody. Went in, went up to the counter, got a slice of pizza, and I just looked across the counter at this kid, this, like, you know, young college kid, freshman in college, who, total stranger. And I was like, you know what? I just have to tell something. I was just up at Skywalker Ranch playing with Luke Skywalker's lightsaber. I am a finalist to be the new Anakin Skywalker. Isn't that amazing? And he said, no way, man. That is so cool. My cousin is Natalie Portman. My parents own the llama farm adjacent to Skywalker Ranch. And I almost fainted on the spot. And I remember stumbling backwards with my pizza in my hand like this, and he says, what's your name? And I said, Misha Collins. And I walked like half a block down the street like a zombie, and then I came back in, and I was like, don't tell anyone I told you that, please. I literally told the worst person in the world by my big secret. And he was the only person I told. So anyway, I take that as my proudest moment as an actor.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi.
Hi. My question to you is, if Meg was alive in the alternate universe, how would Cass feel seeing her again?
I think that we see, and you will see a little bit more of this, but that when we come across alternate universe versions of characters, we can't help but feel connected and familiar with them, even though we don't actually know them at all. They're really different characters. So I think that there would be that connection with Meg too. It's kind of interesting. I thought about this a little bit, but I think that the fact that happens in the show is sort of pointing to the fact that maybe there's like these almost innate bonds between people. Like if they're at their deepest level, their human natures are attracted to one another or something, because it seems to be happening again and again. Yeah.
Hi. I was just wondering, what is the funniest way you've ever been injured?
Funniest way you've been injured?
I have stories I can't tell you. Oh man, that's a wonderful question. It's so good. Yeah, you know it. I have to think about it though. It's not coming to me. I know people must have laughed quite heartily at something I've done. What is it? Do you have any ideas for me?
That's my eyes too.
Yeah. This is close to a good answer, but not quite. all right. So when I was in college, I had roommates, and I had bought 10 giant yams because they were on sale and really cheap. And then they were getting old, and I was like, I better cook these and eat them before they go bad. And so I baked them all. They're big, like this big. And I brought them out of the oven, and I thought, well, I should really make hay while the sun shines here. I had 5 roommates, and so I said, I bet you guys $10 a piece that I can eat all 10 of these yams in 10 minutes.
Oh, God.
It was a yam a minute, which seemed reasonable to me. And I made it, it was like 8 minutes in, and I was at like almost finishing yam 3, and I swallowed, and I was like, okay, I'm out, I cannot do this, I'm not gonna make it. And by that point, I think my stomach was pretty much completely full of yam. And now I was stuffed, feeling disgusting, and out $50. And I don't like to lose. So I wandered into the pantry, and I saw this bottle of apple cider vinegar. And I thought to myself, well, I actually remember, it was a don't throw me in the briar patch moment, where I remember that as a kid, me and my brother would take sips of apple cider vinegar, and we actually kind of liked it. So it was this pint-sized bottle. I brought it back out in the kitchen for my 5 roommates, and I said, double or nothing, but I can drink this in 10 minutes. And they were like, that sounds like a good investment to us. So I went like this, and I was like, I'm just gonna get it down like that. And so I just went chug, chug, and on the second chug, I projectile vomited all over the kitchen. So I lost $100, and I had to clean up after. That's sort of an injury. Yeah, of my own making, for sure. Thanks for bringing that up.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hi,
I'm Misha.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, thank you.
So I was wondering, what's something that you know well enough that you would feel confident teaching another person?
The alphabet. the magic knot.
Woo!
That's a game changer. Who doesn't know? Who knows what the magic knot is? Only a handful of people. Well, I'm so excited about this opportunity. Are you wearing lace shoes right now?
Yes.
Would you mind joining me? Ladies and gentlemen, this is Dimitri. Dimitri, Dimitri, Dimitri. Okay, so, do you know the magic knot? You do? Sweet. So now we can show everyone in the audience. So if you are possessed of laces on your shoe, please follow along. Just untie one shoe. And we have two models up here who are showing you how to do it. And if, by the way, I see you're not. No, your shoes, what's up? Thank you. And can you do the other one, actually? Thank you. Because, ma'am, you don't have laces, so you should be using her other lace. So feel free to use your neighbor's shoe if you have my permission. Everybody, don't be weirded out by somebody touching your foot for science. Okay, so you start with your shoe untied. And this is where...
difficult. Okay.
So... you start with a regular bone up, right? So you do that little crossover thing everybody's familiar with, right? The half hitch, as we call it in nautical circles. And then you start to do your bow. And some people do a bow by taking two bows and sort of crossing them over. Some people do a bow like this, where you loop it around and pull it through. Either way is fine. The magic knot doesn't discriminate. So once you get it to this point, where you're about ready to cinch it down, and you have this opening in the middle, instead of cinching it down, take one of the ears of your bow knot and loop it back through that center hole one more time. Now cinch it down like that. This is an amazing knot because it's not going to come untied. It's like a double knot. It will not come untied all day. You're going to go out and do about business. You're going to chase thieves in the street or whatever. Your laces aren't going to come undone. But when you're ready to take your shoe off, instead of struggling with trembling fingers, breaking your nails, trying to pry open a double knot, you're done. Totally free bonus that made your gold pass investment completely worth it. The amount of time you will save, that you won't trip over yourself once and injure yourself. This will probably save you a hospital trip. Right? Yeah. Thank you for allowing me to showcase that, and thank you for helping. Thank you. By the way, 2 weeks ago, same dolly grip that came up to me and told me to look at my castmates and think that I hate them, came up to me and said, "Hey, I just wanted to thank you for the magic knot. You showed me like 3 years ago, and I use it every day now, and it has changed my life." So, it's a big deal.
Hi.
Hi.
My name is Elizabeth, and obviously there's a lot of shenanigans on set, but how easy or awkward was it to shoot this Scooby-Doo episode because of it just being voiceovers?
The Scooby episode worked for us on a lot of levels. One, it was kind of genre-bending and amazing, something that we're really proud of. And two, we only had to go in for a couple of hours of work. It was a real bonus. So the way it worked, though, was kind of amazing to all of us, because none of us had done this before. We went into a recording studio for about 2.5 hours. And that, for us, covered the entire Scooby natural animated portion of the show. We went in and did that more than a year ago. So it took them a full year to animate the episode once they had all the voice tracks laid down. And then we had 2.5 days of shooting for the rest of the live action portion of the episode. And normally it's eight days of shooting. So for us, we cut 5 days off our schedule by doing the animated version of the show. So we're really happy about that. And also, when you're doing an animated character, all those scenes are much easier, like putting on your wardrobe, getting your makeup done, or fixing your hair and stuff like that is much, much more efficient because you don't have to be there at all.
Thank you.
Hi.
Sorry, this is my first convention, so I'm really nervous. My name's Ashley.
Hi, Ashley.
They literally just stole my question, so I've come up with something off the top of my head. It's okay.
I hate having to come up with things off the top of my head. It's frustrating.
With the episode of Scooby Natural that you just done, how does it compare to your favorite regular Scooby-Doo episode?
Oh.
Does that make sense? I don't even know.
It makes perfect sense. I hate to say it, but I think it was better.
Yeah.
No, I did not see it.
I've been getting a lot of comments about him this weekend, actually.
I bet you have. This is the right crowd to be wearing Supernatural shoes.
Yes.
Yes, it is. I think it was better because I liked, you know, we were nervous, or producers were nervous about some of the elements that went into the Scooby Natural episode, because there were, in actual Scooby Natural episodes, nobody actually ever gets cut in half. Bones don't actually break, and the villains are always just real estate developers and not actual supernatural spirits. So, the idea that they were playing with a little bit was, for the first time for those characters, the shit gets real. Shaggy actually broke his leg. He's like, wait a minute, I actually broke my leg. Like, usually I just fall out of it. Whatever, doesn't matter. I was just impressed that I remembered that element at all. How do you make me feel bad? I think that it was really cool that we got to like push the limits even within Scooby-Doo, and that, you know, Lydia's like severed body and hung in the room for a moment. That was pretty disgusting, and I think everybody thought, oh, they're not gonna let us do that. And then the world came here. And when we were in the recording booth, Jensen swore that there was a scripted line, and then Jensen said that, and then he also, you know, recorded a version where he swore, just as a joke, and that made it into the episode. They blurred out his mouth and beeped, but he actually did swear, and they used it, which was also pretty cool, because that's definitely the first time there's been someone being bleeped on Scooby-Doo.
Thank you.
Thank you. I liked a lot of different elements of it. I liked the chase scene where we wound up in the washing machine. I liked all the parts where Dean was hitting on Daphne. I liked when Cass was a hero and he dove after Shaggy and Scooby. There were a lot of different little scenes that I like. What did you like, though, more importantly?
Well, I kind of like that scene where, like, Cass was like, Dean, there's a talking dog.
Yeah. It's a good line. Yeah. What a surreal thing. What a strange job we have. Yeah. Cool. You liked it, though.
Yes.
Now, how old are you?
14.
How long have you been watching Supernatural for?
About a year and a half.
Okay, that's good. Had you ever seen Scooby-Doo before?
Yes.
Really? Where? How? Like, were you in some old person archives or something?
No, I used to, like, buy all the DVDs when I was little.
Really? Wow, that's amazing. That's really cool to hear. So people actually, young people, still know what Scooby-Doo is.
Yeah.
Really? That's amazing. I thought for sure this was something that only had relevance to us in our deep middle age.
Speaking
of deep middle age.
Boo, stupid Mike.
They're not booing. They're actually really excited for me to get off. The gag's not working, Rich. Guys, where's everybody going? Look, see? I'm out of here.
Man, they just stormed the exit.
I think somebody may have farted toward the front. Here we are, guys. Here we are. What's that?
Thank you all.
Take off your shirt.
Now they give a run to the door so people stop.
That's now in
if they set necessary requests for me. They were personal. I have no idea what she said.
The magic knot on the shoe?
Imagine.
It works?
Yeah.
You like it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. I'll show you guys later in the green room.
Okay.
All right.
Good. That makes me unsettled. How was your time with the fine people of my hometown?
They were very, very gentle with me. It was really lovely.
That's weird.
They have a lot of negative things to say about you.
That makes sense.
You're quite infamous here.
I don't know if you know this, but this is the city of my birth. I'm from Nashville, Tennessee.
Really? You never mentioned that before.
Oh, I forgot to say this.
Yeah.
Welcome to MeCon. You see, the con's all about me and my humble beginnings. I've simplified. I've streamlined. It doesn't need about supernatural and all the sort of trappings that come with that. It's about me.
Yeah, that does simplify things.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. I think we're gonna see a big boost in draw.
You know what?
We're gonna have to get a bigger venue next time.
Oh yeah.
It's HimCon.
I'll tell you something. At MeCon, you know who's always welcome? Me. Chuck Collins, everybody.